Estella for the win. Misses.
Seasons don't feel the reaper, nor do the wind, the sun, or the rain. We can be like they are. Come on, baby, don't feel the reaper. Baby, take my hand, don't feel the reaper. We'll be able to fly, don't feel the reaper. Baby, I'm your man.
I am muted. Hello, everyone. TJ here with Dead History. Welcome to a very special live stream that we have tonight. I have two wonderful, wonderful guests with me. You're going to be introduced to them here in a second. Hope you enjoyed our little intro. The song choice was by Dr. Costello with his wonderful humor of Don't Fear the Reaper there, because we're going to be talking about a very, very wonderful book that both of these individuals are involved in, of course, and that is Mourning the Presidents. It's Mourning the Presidents, Loss and Legacy in American Culture. And I have with me tonight Dr. Lindsay Chervinsky. Dr. Chervinsky is a senior fellow at the Center for Presidential History at Southern Methodist University and currently is a fellow at the Kluge Center at the Library of Congress. She received her BA with honors in history and political science from George Washington University, her master's and PhD from the University of California, Davis, and her postdoctoral fellowship from Southern Methodist University. Previously, Dr. Chervinsky worked as a historian at the White House Historical Association, and her writing has appeared. I'm going to list several of them. It'd probably be easy for me not to list what she hasn't been published in, but The Wall Street Journal, Miss Magazine, The Daily Beast, The Bulwark, Time Magazine, USA Today, CNN, NBC Think, and The Washington Post. She is an award-winning author. Many of you on this live stream, I'm sure, have read her book, The Cabinet, George Washington and the Creation of an American Institution. She is the co-editor of the book we're speaking about tonight, Mourning the Presidents, Loss and Legacy in American Culture. She does have a forthcoming book on our second president, John Adams, coming up next year. And my other guest tonight is Dr. Matthew Costello. He is vice president of the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History and senior historian for the White House Historical Association. He received his PhD and MA in American History at Marquette University and BA from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He has published articles in the Journal of History and Cultures, Essays in History, and White House History Quarterly. His first book, another favorite of mine, The Property of the Nation, George Washington's Tomb, Mount Vernon, and the Memory of the First President. It was published by University Press of Kansas. It was a finalist for the George Washington Book Prize. He is co-editor of Mourning the Presidents, Loss and Legacy in American Culture, which will be published by the University of Virginia Press. And he is also working on a book project that explores Theodore and Edith Roosevelt, as well as their children and staff, and how they shaped the presidency and White House. And Dr. Costello also teaches a course on the history of the White House at American University. So welcome to both of you. Thank you so very much for being here tonight. I truly appreciate it. I hope I got all of that correct with your introductions there. And just so everyone knows, I was privileged enough to be able to read this book ahead of time, Mourning the Presidents. And to both of you, kudos. It is a fabulous, wonderful book. So first and foremost, I just want to start. When does the book officially get released? When is the release date of the book?
Well, TJ, thank you so much for having us. And thank you for those introductions. We really need to cut those down. It's a lot to make you read.
I think you need to write less. That's the problem. Sorry.
Or you need a shorter title. Either would work.
I was going to tell him to take a breath before he started, but
it's like going through a tunnel. The book is officially out on Monday, February 20th, President's Day. We're very excited. It has been a long time in coming, got slightly delayed by the pandemic, but a long time in coming and very excited to finally have it out in the world.
Well, we're very excited to have it because I know a lot of people that are going to be watching this tonight. We already have 1,000 people joining us live right now. I can tell you right now that it's wonderful. Somebody like me, it's right up my alley. I am kind of a presidential grave hunter, so to speak. I visited all the presidential grave sites. So when I saw this book coming out, I was like, oh, this is going to be amazing and wonderful. So one of the things I did want to kind of jump right into and ask you guys about, of course, the book, it obviously talks about you know, the death of certain presidents. But then it really talks about their legacy, you know, what their presidency meant. And then, of course, what their legacy is going to be even after their death and what it, you know, has appeared to be and how it's changed over time. And I found that quite interesting because when I first started visiting all these grave sites, I was invited to do presentations at different universities and such. And here in New Jersey, at Rowan University, I did my first presentation ever a couple of years ago. And one of the things I said, ironically, was I noticed even visiting the grave sites of our presidents, how they've changed so dramatically over the years, just aesthetically. You know, of course, you know, you have the first founding father president, so to speak, a lot of them buried right at their home plantations and their home estates, grounds. And then you start to get into those presidents, you know, from Lincoln on, where all of a sudden it's these grand monuments and huge tombs to these presidents. And now we've kind of gone the other way, where a lot of presidents now are buried at their presidential libraries and museums and the grounds there. So I found that interesting. And I always kind of thought about how, is that kind of because of how society has changed over time, of course, and how we viewed the presidency, or how we've maybe had a fascination with the presidency, where I feel like the presidency, the office of the presidency, is maybe not as highly revered as it once was, as silly as that may sound. It's just interesting to me how it's changed so much over time. So if one of you guys or both of you could touch on how has the presidency and the loss of a president and their legacy afterwards, how has that really changed over the course of time from Washington all the way up to George H.W. Bush, our last president, of course, to pass away?
That's a big question. Maybe I'll give my two cents and then Matt can jump in since there's a lot to talk about there. So I think on one hand, it's a product of how, of course, society has changed. So most of us don't own plantations anymore, and we aren't typically buried at our home site. We are often, some people are cremated, some people are buried at various sites, some people, there are lots of creative ways in which to express loss. So I think that partly it's just a product of society doing things differently. And as you noted, especially in the 20th century, the rise of presidential libraries has really changed how we think about presidential legacy and preserving of presidential records, preserving of presidential history. And presidents have now a very large role to play in crafting that space, crafting what that space is intended for, what messages they want to convey. And they often, because they are so closely affiliated with it, then do select it as their final resting site. So I would say that that lends us to a couple of conclusions. One, the role of the president in society has shifted from one that in theory was much smaller, although I would actually argue kind of ebbs and flows over time, up through the 20th century, where now it is a very powerful institution, even if the person themselves are not necessarily revered in the same way. Mm-hmm. And then things like technology and how news is passed and how we learn about things, how people are able to transport themselves or their loved ones, all of those things have shifted as well and have changed the mourning process and what we like physically do with the president's bodies a whole lot. Yeah. Matt, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with all of that. I would add that, you know, over time we've seen, you know, different political, social, cultural movements that elevated the presidency, I think, to an extent where it's seen as more powerful than the other branches of government. I think American citizens' role in electing a president and the expansion of that right has also played a role, because more and more Americans feel connected to their leader, because more and more Americans can vote for their leader. You know, that wasn't always the case, but it is the case today. And when you mentioned some of the mausoleums or monuments that were built in the 19th century, oftentimes those presidents, it wasn't something that they intended or asked for. So I think that tells us that it was almost as if the people or their bodies themselves extended beyond the office of the presidency, mm-hmm. right? That people felt that these leaders belonged to them even beyond death. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that's necessarily the case anymore, but I think presidential libraries have in a way replaced it. Yeah, I mean, you could look at a presidential library or presidential museum as a monument of sorts for that president and their legacy. Now, in part because of what Franklin Roosevelt did in creating the first presidential library and turning it over to the National Archives, is that, yes, it'll be documented, everything will go there, the artifacts, the objects, the paper, but also to have a more objective view of presidents and their legacies. And this is also part of the debate that's ongoing today, is who will control these narratives at these presidential libraries. And I think when a president spends so much time to get to the office, and then they're there for 4 or 8 years, and then they're told, we need to build a presidential library, they invest so much of themselves in creating that experience. And so I think for many of them, they also look to precedent. You know, more recent presidents have been buried at their presidential libraries or museums, and they see it as just sort of the natural final resting place to be there as people are coming to learn about them, learn about their lives, and learn about their administration.
No, it's, you both make excellent points, and that's kind of exactly the way I've always viewed it when I was visiting these sites. And of course, the presidential libraries, like we know, that's kind of like the norm now in the last, say, 70 years, 60, 70 years. But, you know, then you have somebody, of course, like our wonderful president, former president Jimmy Carter, who's 98 and he's still trucking along, going to be 99 in October. And, you know, obviously grave hunters like ourselves, we're always wondering where are these people going to be buried. We always like to visit these places. And at least supposedly, Jimmy Carter does not have plans to be buried at his presidential library in Atlanta, Georgia. He actually is opting to be buried at his home in Plains, Georgia. So it's quite interesting because, you know, it's been such the norm, as we know. Mm-hmm. And now President Carter might kind of disrupt that sort of, or I shouldn't say disrupt, but change the way of doing things a little bit. Now, one thing that I did find fascinating, but unfortunately upsetting for me, and I'm sure anybody that will read the book, of course, knows the ugly, ugly history of slavery when it comes to the relationship with Thomas Jefferson, our third president. He is my favorite president. Not my favorite person, of course, but, you know, I've been to Monticello, you know, I've seen it, I've loved it, I experienced it. But after reading the chapter in this book, I was really taken back how he seems to be the one president that spoke about in this book that his death affected so many people in a terribly negative way, because, of course, meaning the enslaved people that Thomas Jefferson owned there at Monticello. It's, you know, these people's lives were so highly affected and so greatly affected because families were torn apart. You know, some of the enslaved people, or a lot of them, were sold off by Jefferson family members, and then they were separated. So if you guys could just kind of touch on that for a few minutes here, how that had such a profound effect on generations of African-American people that obviously were related to the enslaved people, the African-American enslaved people there at Monticello. It's quite horrific and quite terrible. And I don't think, at least from the conclusion I drew from the book, that there's ever really been a president that their death, their actual death, had such a negatively profound effect against so many people. So if you guys can touch on that a little bit.
Yeah, well, first we need to give credit to Andrew Davenport, who's the author of the Jefferson chapter. He's also a historian at Monticello, and perhaps most movingly, he himself is a descendant through the Hemings family line. So he was really the perfect person to tell this story from in a very meaningful and substantive and historical, but also personal way. Certainly other presidents' deaths have caused the sale or the auctioning or the gifting of enslaved individuals to family members or friends. We wouldn't want anyone to think Jefferson was the only one. I think Jefferson is unique in that when he died, and Andrew discusses this, his estate was so deeply in debt that the only way to cover those debts was to hold a large-scale auction of the enslaved individuals and the house. And so in some cases, some of the individuals were able to select the people that bought them, whether they were in Virginia or close by. Maybe they had a family connection. Maybe one of their family members was also owned by that person as a way to retain some of those kinship ties. But most people were auctioned to the Deep South, where there was a growing cotton empire and a vast demand for enslaved labor. And as you said, that did rip apart family members in ways that were still felt generations and centuries later, because some people really haven't been able to track their ancestors. One of the things, my lighting is always in flux, always a problem with Zoom. One of the things that I think Andrew does a really phenomenal job of telling the story is that that impact of the disparate results for people who were able to stay close to Virginia and people who were sold into the Deep South, it's not often discussed, but is so essential, because the people who were sold locally were often able to purchase their own manumission or purchase the manumission of their families, and were able to start crafting family ties and family lineages and retaining property far sooner than those that had to wait until after the end of the Civil War. So it's a legacy that is so much longer and broader than we can even possibly imagine.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, this was one of my favorite chapters, the volume, because I think the immediate assumption is that we're going to be talking about how people celebrated Jefferson. There were parades and there were processions and there were mock funerals, but this sort of turns that entire process on its head. Mm-hmm. Where we've been so fixated on maybe how white Americans mourned George Washington. Well, what about Black Americans? What about Black members of Jefferson's own family? Yeah. Some of whom were enslaved and then sold. And it's a story that becomes less about Jefferson, but more how the shackles of enslavement continued beyond his death. And really how the Hemings family and other families were able to persevere through that. And I mean, that to me is sort of when you're reading the end of the chapter and you're learning about the Getting Word Project, you're learning about Andrew visiting and gathering with other descendants, that ultimately this becomes a story of hope, a story of people feeling connected to a place even though their ancestors had no choice about that connection. And you can just tell how personal the history really is. And to me, as a reader, I mean, I was enthralled by not only the history and the demise of Jefferson, but also how that burden of his legacy continued beyond Monticello.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It was a fascinating, probably my favorite chapter of the book as well, like you said, Dr. Costello. And it was there was times it was a little hard to read. It's very emotional, and it's like it really does make you stop and think of the impact, not just the actual enslaved people that were there at Monticello, but the generations, as we just said, of those enslaved people afterward. And it's funny because I'm actually taking a trip in April with my son out to the Midwest. He wants to see Lincoln's tomb. He likes to do all this stuff. And we're kind of driving back, and we are actually going to Monticello on our way back. But after reading this chapter, we're actually going to stop and see the gravesite. It's actually, I was just looking at it here in Cincinnati, of Peter Fawcett, who was an enslaved man who I learned, of course, in this book. He was an enslaved man at Monticello, and years later, it was his wish to visit and go back to Monticello. And I found that absolutely fascinating. So I told my son he's actually buried in Cincinnati, Ohio, and we're going to be stopping there to visit his gravesite and pay our respects to him. And just so I can kind of tell the story and explain to my son exactly, the ties between this man that we're visiting and the place that we're going to go see a couple days after that. So very fascinating stuff. The other thing I loved that this book did was it discussed some of the obscure presidents that we never hear so much about, of course, like Zachary Taylor is mentioned, Herbert Hoover. And the thing I found fascinating about Herbert Hoover, he seemed to be, I mean, I know, of course, FDR is the one that came up and created the presidential library idea and that sort of thing. But Hoover seemed to be one of the first presidents that, you know, after his presidency, he was so enthralled in like the whole planning of his grave site, his burial site and his library and all that stuff, almost to kind of maybe try to have a different, have the public have a little bit of a different view, maybe skew them down a different path of what, how they viewed President Hoover. Because of course, as historians say, and I've had many historians on this channel, probably one of our graded, at least as one of our worst presidents ever. So, you know, are they all now, from the research that you guys did, are all the presidents from, you know, Hoover and FDR on, are they all so involved in their final resting places and their legacies afterward, you know, once they die? Or has that been the case now for the last 50 years or so? Or is that something where there's some presidents that don't seem as hands-on with it, with the research that you guys have done?
So generally speaking, you know, since Franklin Roosevelt created the FDR Presidential Library and set aside that Rose Garden space to be buried in, it's been fairly consistent that presidents are involved with this idea of a presidential library, their final resting place. Now, there are exceptions to that rule. Obviously, you know, John F. Kennedy was not expecting the tragedy that befell him in 1963. And Mrs. Kennedy selected Arlington National Cemetery as his, mm-hmm. as his burial site. And also, they hadn't even really gotten to the part where they were talking about a John F. Kennedy Presidential Library. You know, he was in Texas gearing up for another campaign run. So that was an example of, and you could speak to this many different ways in terms of presidential succession, in terms of presidential libraries. There wasn't that type of planning in place in advance of what happened on November 22nd, 1963. So after Kennedy's assassination, I think much more attention was given to presidents, their plans in terms of a state funeral, where they want to be buried, where they want to have a presidential library, and to periodically revisit those plans, because you never really knew with a variety of different health ailments. You know, for example, LBJ had a heart attack earlier in his life. You know, he was, so again, it was one of those things where they always had to periodically revisit. Same thing with Ronald Reagan. You know, he undergoes surgery and has to temporarily transfer the powers of the presidency to George H.W. Bush. And that continues today. You know, presidents will revisit their after office, afterlife plans to ensure that, in, I think the best example of that was the George H.W. Bush chapter, where it talks about sort of the final mm-hmm. stages that Bush 41 had.
Yeah, I think one of the funnier elements of the book that I learned as I was reading the Bush 41 chapter that Matthew mentioned is that Bush had very strong opinions about what he wanted to have happen when he died, mm-hmm. but he didn't want to talk about legacy. He wanted that to be other people's projects, mm-hmm. and he felt like he shouldn't really have a role in crafting what his legacy was. He wanted certain things to be remembered and emphasized in the museum, but apparently in some conversations, he actually banned what he called the L word. Okay. Now, other presidents have not taken that tact, so we don't have a chapter on Nixon, but Nixon was obsessed with trying to rehabilitate himself, not unlike Herbert Hoover, who spent decades trying to explain why he had taken the actions or the lack of actions that he did in the Great Depression leading up to his loss to FDR. And then, you know, presidents like Reagan, his family was really in charge of that legacy building project. And so that's one element that I hope the volume contributes, is it's often the president, but more often than not, the family has some role in deciding what is remembered, how it is remembered, where it is remembered. Even if they do live beyond office, sometimes, usually the family outlives them.
Yeah. And you know, I found it interesting, like you're talking about plans, of course, you know, what they want their legacy to be, or how they're trying to shape it, of course, or even specific details about maybe their funeral and such. And like, I know FDR, he had specific details written out that he wanted, how he wanted his funeral to be, because, but of course, his sudden death, even though he was ill, it was pretty sudden, of course. and his son never got to actually open the letter that explained all this. So there was a lot of his funeral details that were not really what he wanted and wished for. So I found that very interesting, how that obviously can change depending on, you know, untimely death or that sort of thing. The other thing you brought up JFK, Dr. Costello. So he is, I've been hearing about JFK since I've been about 4 years old. I grew up in a Kennedy household, obviously, you know, my Bobby Kennedy shirt here. And I found it interesting that, you know, the chapter about Kennedy speaks so highly about how he was revered so wonderfully by the African-American community in the country after, you know, his passing, you know, but there's been plenty of historians over time who have said that, you know, the African-American community during his presidency kind of had a mixed view of John F. Kennedy, who they felt maybe even dragged his feet a bit, even on the civil rights issue. And of course, you know, Lyndon Johnson's the one who signed, you know, civil rights legislation into law and that sort of thing. And, you know, but Kennedy, it seems like he gets a lot of credit for that. And not that he doesn't deserve any credit, but it's just, is it because of his such the tragic death that, you know, things that maybe he wasn't so fast on, or he maybe dragged his feet on, or a little bit forgotten, or a little bit forgiven, so to speak. If you guys want to just speak to that for a minute about how it seems like someone's legacy in tragedy, of course, like Kennedy's, he seems to be so highly revered and he's very highly ranked among presidential historians. But, you know, there are things where historians will take a look at his actual presidency, his time in office, and say, well, you know, some wonderful things and some things that maybe weren't so wonderful. But does he get lifted up because of the tragedy of his death? If you guys will speak to that for a minute.
Sure. Well, I do think his ranking is starting to come down a little bit from its lofty heights. Certainly in the last C-SPAN presidential poll, it dropped a bit. And I think this is one of the great examples of how American sentiment about presidents are not necessarily the same as history about presidents, because I agree with you, you know, in terms of pure achievement, LBJ accomplishes a whole lot more for the civil rights movement. But I think one of the arguments that Dr. Sharon Conrad makes is that there are a couple of things that really endear Kennedy to the African American community. First was he was the first to sort of make a bold public statement on behalf of civil rights. And sure, words are not action. And, you know, maybe you can say that action is more powerful, but she makes the argument that that first symbolic step was really, really important, that someone spoke out on behalf of it. Second, that the way he died, of course, was tragic. It sort of had echoes of Lincoln because of course, the way he was killed, but also the time at which he was killed when it seemed like there was a civil rights moment. And that led to this sort of conviction that maybe he was killed because he had taken this stance, that maybe he was killed because he had put his neck out for the African-American community and civil rights. And so that lent to a further sense of martyrdom in a way that maybe we wouldn't necessarily see otherwise. Matt, do you think that that's a fair assessment?
Yeah, I mean, I think a big part of it was there had been civil rights bills previously, but African-American leaders continue to come to the White House to visit presidents to push for more and to get more federal government involvement in enforcing and protecting these rights. And Kennedy, you know, he puts a civil rights bill forward, but he knows it's not gonna go anywhere, not with the Southern Democrats. And really it's just gonna be sort of in a holding pattern. And he's a politician, you know, he's looking forward to a re-election, right? And he even says, you know, his second term is gonna be the term where he really digs in and goes after civil rights. Now, that doesn't happen, and Lyndon Johnson was never one to not make use of a crisis or not make use of a tragedy. I mean, that was what made Lyndon Johnson the choice for vice president. He knew how to get things done. He knew how the levers of government operated. He knew the pressure points. He knew when to be soft with people, and he knew when to be hard with people. And so Johnson is able to take that national tragedy and essentially call on other politicians to pass this in memory of Kennedy. And it becomes then almost sort of a referendum on whether or not you agree with the tragedy of the assassination. And so Johnson, even though, you know, for most of his career had voted against civil rights, you know, he sees it. This is the time. The time is now to push forward on civil rights. President Kennedy has started pushing this, you know, down the hill, and now it's up to us to move it. And the really surprising thing, and you probably got this from the chapter, is that African Americans generally don't have that same view or connection with Lyndon Johnson. And that view persisted for quite a while after Kennedy's death. And I think the other point I would make is that, and this speaks to what Lindsay said earlier, John F. Kennedy is starting to slip in the presidential rankings. And I think that's because we are now getting further removed from the assassination. There's been new scholarship, and, you know, people are now growing up and they don't really remember. They don't remember. They weren't alive when Kennedy was assassinated. They weren't alive when the funeral took place. You know, that generation is getting older and older. And soon enough, we're going to be far enough removed from the assassination where, you know, people aren't going to be holding on to those sentiments anymore, right? They're going to be looking more at his presidential record, his achievements. And I would expect that Kennedy will continue to slip. I don't know how far he will go, but I think he will continue to slip. And eventually, I think LBJ will probably move ahead of him.
Interesting. Well, very interesting. So speaking on that, we're talking about presidential assassinations. Of course, we've had four presidents assassinated. So why is it that there is not the sentiment for President Garfield and President McKinley, of course, as there is Lincoln and Kennedy? Now, I obviously know the accomplishments of Lincoln and Kennedy are much greater. Garfield was in office for a very short period of time. However, there's not this sentiment. It's amazing. You know, you ask the general American public to name the four presidents that were assassinated. Mm-hmm. You're lucky if they can name even one, but they're only naming you Lincoln and Kennedy. I can assure you of that. No one even remembers Garfield and McKinley. And Garfield, who many historians will agree, I'm sure, that had so much potential, a brilliant man who knows what would have happened if he would have lived. So why is it? Is it just the short amount of time that Garfield was in office that you attribute that to? Is it just the maybe lack of dynamic personality or something of someone like McKinley? Why is it that it's so forgotten with those two and the other two are just so in the American psyche and the American public's eye?
So I have two theories. One is sort of situational in that, you know, Garfield didn't actually die from the assassination. He died from the botched medical care afterwards. And it took such a long time that I think it kind of sapped the death of the shockingness. Mm-hmm. And so it didn't have that same sort of tragic effect as the immediacy of Lincoln and Kennedy. Partly, I think that was also situational in terms of like when he came in the line of presidencies. That period of time in American history is not really showered with glory in terms of, you know, presidential success. Although for anyone who's on the social medias, the Garfield site Twitter is a gift and one of the true treasures of the United States. Oh my gosh. The Garfield MPS site is phenomenal.
That's Todd Arrington, people.
Yes. Todd Arrington is the funniest person on Twitter, and they are bringing back a Garfield with a vengeance.
I love it.
My second theory is it depends a lot on who comes after. So it's really hard to get excited about McKinley when Theodore Roosevelt comes after. Yes. Whereas, you know, Lincoln is followed by Andrew Johnson. So not that Lincoln wasn't going to have a sparkling reputation anyway, but Johnson did certainly help him out.
Yeah. And I think the other thing I would add to that is I think Kennedy's was so raw because it was so recent. It was
televised.
There's video. People can watch this fruit of film. There was obviously a commission if people really wanted to learn more about it. Mm-hmm. So that, and of course, everybody watched the Kennedy funeral. You know, something like 90-95% of Americans were tuning in to watch that funeral. They remember John Jr. saluting his father. I mean, these are images that are burned into the American consciousness. Mm-hmm. Now, with the other three, you have Kennedy, Garfield, McKinley. That's three presidents assassinated in 36 years. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is basically, you know, within your lifetime, you could have seen.
Right?
Yes, Lincoln, Garfield, McKinley. So within 36 years, it's essentially one generation. You could have seen three presidents killed. You know, I think maybe by McKinley, maybe it wasn't as shocking anymore because it's happened three times, right? Lincoln is, of course, the Civil War is drawing to an end. Robert E. Lee has surrendered. It appears that the Union has been saved. Slavery will be abolished officially through, it's been passed in Congress, needs to be ratified. And that there's so much hope, you know, looking forward. And the fact that he's assassinated is, I mean, it's one of the most tragic parts of the war is to lose a leader like that when he was so close to securing victory and securing all the things that he had fought for. You know, Garfield, very short. I think Lindsay has an excellent point. He doesn't immediately die. He lingers. And so people are just sort of keeping up to date. And then eventually he succumbs to his wounds and the infections. And then McKinley, you know, there's been some recent scholarship reevaluating McKinley and his role in sort of setting up what becomes, you know, the American century. You know, the United States becoming more of an imperial power in places like the Caribbean, in places like Asia. So there is new scholarship coming out on McKinley, but I think Lindsay also has a very good point, is, you know, the country mourned and then was immediately overwhelmed by the personality of Theodore Roosevelt.
Of course.
There's a great book called How to Hide an Empire,
yeah,
by Daniel Immerwahr that looks at that period of history and I think makes the case that Matthew was saying about McKinley being more pivotal than we give him credit for.
Interesting. Now, obviously, over the last several years, there's been a lot in our society, you know, regarding police brutality and the way, you know, civil rights and the way persons of color are treated, of course. And there's been a lot of light shined upon some of this ugly history that our country obviously has been a part of. A lot of statues and things have been taken down and removed. So my question to both of you is, you know, that this book, of course, speaks about presidential legacy and the legacy of the person after they're long gone. Do you think that as time goes on here and more people are studying the lives of these, you know, founding fathers and such, that people like Thomas Jefferson and even George Washington are going to be kind of diminished in their godlike way, that, you know, when I was growing up, there was nobody better than George Washington, of course, and he chopped down the cherry tree and he couldn't tell a lie and all that nonsense, of course. And, you know, now that everybody is really looking at a lot of issues in our society and things are really, you know, coming out about the way that some of these people lived their lives and the horrible things they did, do you think people like that, like Jefferson and Washington, are going to diminish in how people look at them? Or are they just kind of untouchable where they're always going to be at the top, even if there is ugly stains of things they did in their lives?
Well, I certainly do think that some of the individuals in particular will come down a notch. And that doesn't mean that they're going to be forgotten or erased or canceled. I think that it means that we are going to look at them as full people, what their full lives were like and what their full stories and histories were. And I think that's right and appropriate. I think it's good that each generation sort of revisits previous history and says, you know, are there any other questions that we want to ask? Are there any new approaches we want to consider? And that doesn't mean that you have to forget or you have to decide not to study someone. It's also perfectly okay to say, you know, I don't necessarily like everything about this person, but I still really respect these elements. That's perfectly acceptable. In terms of the statues and the commemoration, I think it's important we draw a distinction between history and commemoration. Statues are not history. Statues are how we choose to celebrate or honor things. So if we do take a statue down, it is not erasing our history. But I think that commemoration, we have to consider what it is that is being commemorated. So, mm-hmm. For example, if we have a statue of John Marshall on the campus of a law school, we are not celebrating John Marshall's ownership of enslaved individuals. We are celebrating his creation of American jurisprudence in spite of these other sort of horrific things. So we are not celebrating the horrific things first and foremost. And that doesn't mean that we should forget about those things, but it does mean, I think, that it's an important distinction, because that distinction allows us to see a difference. And I think there is a real one between someone like John Marshall and someone like Robert E. Lee, who the statues of Robert E. Lee that were put up to commemorate white supremacy, to commemorate what we would consider to be the worst of him. And so that is, I think, I believe, a critical and important distinction.
Yeah. And, you know, to add to that, you know, the idea of erasing history, you know, to me, that comes to mind things like, you know, ethnic cleansing, burning of archives, destroying materials that tell people stories that can never be recovered. That to me is erasing history. Removing statues is not the same thing. Statues are representations of history. They are put up by a select group of people who raise the money, who select the designer, who select the placement. And so they take all of these things into consideration when they pick the person, the representation, where it's placed. You know, they have their own agendas, they have their own motivations. And so to look to those as this is where we should get our history from is just wrong. You need to be getting your history from primary sources. You need to be getting your history from books like these by historians who write good history, who write fair, objective history. And that is where we should be learning our history from, not from plaques, not from statues, because I think that's a big part of the reason why we've had this discourse over heroes and founders. And it's because so many people have relied on those physical markers to tell them what they need to know about history. And you're only going to get a sliver of the story.
Yeah, very, very good points. So my final question for you guys, because I see we have a couple, you know, questions from the audience. You know, with how divided and how partisan everything is in our country nowadays, do you guys feel that, you know, moving forward, you know, obviously George H.W. Bush was the last president to pass. Do you feel that the celebration of life and the grand spectacle of, you know, the service and the funeral and that sort of thing that, of course, we saw with George H.W. Bush, do you feel that that is going to just keep continuing on as time goes on? Or do you feel that the American public is kind of so divided that they just kind of like, we don't care about some of these people, and it's not going to be this grand spectacle and celebration of these men and hopefully women's lives? You know, if you guys can kind of touch on that, do you feel that it's going to keep going down this path of this grand days long celebration of life, or is it going in legacy, I should say, or is it going to kind of go to the back burner in American society, so to speak?
Well, I will start by saying that historians are generally terrible at predicting the future.
I was going to say the same thing to start.
That is why we spend so much time in the past. It is our safe space. So just looking at how the last several decades have changed with presidents and state funerals, and then also keeping in mind, the you know, as you mentioned, the polarization of where we are. We've gotten to a point now where it's almost like it doesn't really matter who's in office, that we have these. I mean, I would like to think that these types of occasions can be times where there is bipartisanship, where people can show respect for somebody who led the country. It's also going to depend on the individual in question. You mentioned Jimmy Carter earlier. To me, that sounds very Jimmy Carter-esque. You know, Jimmy Carter didn't even really want to build a presidential library, but eventually he was, I think, persuaded to do it because, you know, they thought it could be a place to do more of their work, you know, with different diseases around the world and to do more like public service projects. So he eventually came around to it. So I don't find it all that surprising. I don't think, if I had to guess, he probably isn't going to have a state funeral. my guess is he'll probably have something very simple and he'll stay in Plains, Georgia, because that is what he wants. And that's how he wants to probably be remembered. I mean, he doesn't think he needs the pomp and circumstance. Will other presidents feel that way? I don't know. My guess is not.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it will probably depend on who the president is, and that will shape who participates in that process. So, for example, while his presidency was pretty partisanly divided towards the end, George W. Bush actually has really good relationships with people on both sides of the aisle. So I suspect that not all, but a lot of Americans would participate in remembering the more positive elements of his tenure and his leadership and his personality. And certainly sort of the you know, sort of leadership class than you would typically see at these things. I think at least a fairly broad swath, if not all the way left and all the way right, at least a fairly significant swath would attend and participate in that process. I don't think that's true for everyone. And it will be very interesting to see what happens. I was going to say the same thing, Matt, was that we're really bad at predicting the future. So I really have no idea.
It's an interesting question, though. It's something definitely to think about. Now, just a couple quick questions from the audience. Kurt actually asked, one of my good friends, how did Dr. Costello's work on Property of the Nation lead him to this project? And the second part is, what about this aspect of presidential history appealed to Dr. Chervinsky? So, Dr. Costello, why don't you take that first, please?
Sure. So, the first book was originally my dissertation. And what I did was I used George Washington's tomb at Mount Vernon and these different efforts to try to remove his body and put it elsewhere, and also sort of the happenings at the tomb, you know, the interactions between Washington family members, enslaved people, tourists, to explore what Washington's memory meant in the 19th century. How were Americans remembering him? How were they trying to take pieces, not only of him, but his estate as mementos? And what I wanted to explore with that is, you know, the story with Washington is very fascinating, but he is also, as Lindsay knows, he's a bit of a micromanager. He's a little bit, I would say, there's a jealousy to it, how much he guards his reputation. And so when Washington is gone, there's this immediate question about, well, who will claim Washington now? Who will use Washington to further their political agenda? Who will use Washington to sell trinkets? Who will use Washington to make the case that, you know, he was a Freemason, so the Freemasons are okay, we don't have to condemn them? So there's all these different instances of people using Washington for different means, and it's because everybody, they find something to connect themselves to Washington.
Yeah.
And I think that speaks to his almost universal appeal across political parties, across regions. It seems everybody can find something to rally around in relation to George Washington. And so when George H.W. Bush passed away, I felt like, in a way, it was kind of like we were watching what happened in 1799. We were watching how Americans responded to the death of a former president, and, you know, what were they doing? What were the tributes? How were people showing respect? You know, obviously the office of the presidency is very different between that time period, but I felt like we were watching something very similar. And that's when we came up with this idea of, why not talk about how this process has changed and evolved over time and what it tells us about presidential legacies.
Very interesting.
Yeah. So, I mean, we were very much sparked by the public reaction to George H.W. Bush and how so much of what people were saying about him reflected, I think, a lot more about the American people than they necessarily did Bush 41. And that concept of what the president's relationship to the American people, what that relationship looks like, I find very compelling, because it is the only office that in theory represents all Americans, although that representation at times has been a little bit less equitable than others. And so I've been really fascinated over the last couple of years studying sort of how the office, of course, has changed, how the relationship between Americans and the presidency has changed, but also what is the appropriate role of the presidency? Is it weird that we as a republic, as a nation that was founded sort of in revolution against a monarchy, holds these state funerals for presidents that look an awful lot like the state funerals we saw for Queen Elizabeth II just a couple of months ago. Like, is that really, is that exactly how we want to remember these people who are supposed to be just like any other citizens once they leave office? And so that question of like, what is the right role for the president in society? What is the right amount of respect for the office, but not necessarily the person? That question, I don't necessarily have a perfect answer to. I think probably a lot of people would have different answers, but I think is one that came up again and again as we were exploring the chapters in this volume. And if I may, I'm seeing that Don has asked about, or has said, you know, we didn't mention Grant. There are a couple of people who I wish that we could have included, like thinking back on it now, if I were to go back and like redo our chapters, which, you know, benefit of hindsight and all that. Yes. One that I wish that we had included was Grant, and we didn't. And so, you know, there might just have to be a volume two, because there are a couple other ones that I feel like were a loss.
I was going to say, if you're interested in Grant, I know that there is a published volume of essays on Grant for his, like it's his 200th, the bicentennial of his birth. That yes, just came out. And then there's also Louis Bacon's book on Grant's tomb. I would recommend that if you're interested in specifically awesome. Ulysses S. Grant.
Yes, Louis Bacon's been on my channel before. He's a friend of mine, and it's a phenomenal book. Very, very well done. So the last question I'm going to ask you guys, Kurt's not getting the credit for this because I was already going to ask this. It's about,
sorry, Kurt.
It's about the 39, of course, the 39 presidential grave sites. How many of you guys been to? And you have to tell us each, what is your favorite presidential site? I told you guys, just so everyone knows, they asked me before we came on live, and everybody that watches my channel knows it's Lincoln's tomb. Probably Kennedy is a close second. So there we go. Now it's your turn, guys. You got to give me one. Mm. You have to give me one.
Okay.
All right. So, not intending to insult either you or Kurt, because I know you are both fans of gravesites, but no. I actually like gravesites far less than I do the houses where people lived, because I think that, and I think this is actually one of the things that sparked my love of history as a kid, is my mom would take me to historic places. And as a child, even though I was a voracious reader, you can't really picture like how someone lived until you see the space. And I think that's really what sparked my love of this subject. So my very favorite of the presidential sites that I have been to is is Peacefield, which is the Adams House in Quincy, Massachusetts. I should confess, my dog's name is John Quincy Dog Adams. I'm writing a book on John Adams. I have a soft spot for the Adams family. But the reason I like it so much is, one, it was a little bit more modest than Mount Vernon or Monticello or Montpelier. I think it probably was more cozy, but really, it's the library.
The library.
It's the library that Charles created for John Quincy Adams.
I was going to say, if Room Raider could get their hands on that.
It is the thing that library dreams are made of. And it's covered in wisteria on the outside. It's just spectacular. It's so phenomenal. That's my favorite. So
my son and I just were there with Kurt, actually, this last year. And even my son at the time, he was 8. He was like just like standing there, like just looking around. It's like, It's quite spectacular. It really is. Absolutely. So no, that's, I love that answer. Dr. Costello, what about you, sir?
So back in January, I was up in Long Island and I went to Sagamore Hill. I did some research there. You know, to Lindsay's point, you can't really know Theodore Roosevelt until you've, you know, stepped around his gun case and tried not to trip on tiger rugs and things like that. And, you know, I turned to the NPS guide and I said, this place oozes, TR. And she was like, that is the perfect word to describe it. Oozes. Yeah. And so one day I wrapped up my research early and I decided I was going to walk down the road to Young's Memorial Cemetery, right there, sort of in the split heading towards Oyster Bay. And you get there and you have to open, you know, you kind of open the lock yourself. You walk up the hill and it's just such an unassuming place. I mean, it's a very simple shared cemetery that includes, I think the Young family, the Townsend family, And you finally get to the top. And of course, you know, their gravesite is surrounded with iron fencing, I'm sure because of relic hunters. Not to name names, DJ, or any you or any of your buddies. but I'm sure that fencing was there long before. But anyway, you know, I got to the top of the hill and I turned around and I just kind of looked over the bay and it just immediately hit me. I was like, now I totally understand why he picked this spot. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was just beautiful. And you know, nearby there are some graves of the family members. And then even, you know, some markers for, you know, the children that aren't actually buried there. Ted Jr. and Quentin, you know, are buried, I think, in France now.
Yes.
They were joined together.
Yep.
But they have a marker there. So, I mean, if you know anything about the Roosevelt family and you go there and you see that, then all of a sudden you start thinking about that experience and what it must have felt like for Theodore Roosevelt and Edith Roosevelt to find out their youngest son had been shot down, you know, during World War I. And it's just a very moving place. And so I know that one has really stuck with me. And I think also to Lindsay's point, you know, some of these places it's very grandiose, very opulent. And almost in a way where you're like, this doesn't really seem to fit the person or the personality that, you know, this president was. But I feel like, you know, TR's love of the outdoors, the love of his family, his love of Sagamore Hill, I mean, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. There's another one like that. Calvin Coolidge is up in Plymouth Notch, Vermont. Mm-hmm. It's very Calvin Coolidge-like. It fits his personality for sure. So I want to thank you both. This has been very, very fascinating and wonderful. Everybody, please go get the book this Monday, Mourning the Presidents, The Loss and Legacy in American Culture, wherever you guys buy books. Even though I've already read it, I can't wait to get my copy and read it again. It truly is wonderful. So Dr. Travinsky, Dr. Costello, thank you so very much for being here. I appreciate your time, and thank you so much for this wonderful book and being a part of this wonderful book, because it's fascinating and very well done. And guys, thanks everybody for joining us tonight, and we'll see you guys soon. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much for having us. We really appreciate it.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you.
Absolutely.